Thank you for coming to the presentation by London Black Atheists and Central London Humanist Group. We are holding an event, Witchcraft, Belief, Murder, Misogyny, in the 21st century, which is unbelievable. And we'll be examining the harmful effects of witchcraft belief and the devastating consequences of witch hunts, child abuse, murder, misogyny on women, children, and sometimes even men, plus the steps we can take to combat it. Now, just say a couple of words about London Black Atheists. London Black Atheists was started less than 2 years ago to provide a safe space to enable atheists to come out without the fear of being ostracized by family and friends. And in that space of time, we've grown from 4 people to well over 200. And to give you just one example, just over a week ago, one of our newest members told us that after joining LBA, London Black Atheists, he now feels emboldened enough to go and tell his family that he's an atheist. And so we are here to encourage people and like that. Now, you don't have to be black to join London Black Atheists. And in fact, you don't have to come from London or be a Londoner either. And funny enough, you don't even have to be an atheist. So, as you can see, it's the perfect name. But if you're, obviously, if you're not an atheist, then you can expect your views to be robustly challenged. But what we do is to concentrate on giving encouragement to black people to come out as atheists. But why pick on black people? Because a Gallup poll, for example, conducted in 2013, placed the religious countries in the world and the percentage of the populations as number one, Ghana, with 96% religious, number two, Nigeria, with 93% religious. So you can see where the problems lie. And you know, in other words, if you went to Ghana or Nigeria, pretty much everybody is religious. So we just feel that this is where we should focus our attention. Now, religion does three things effectively. It divides people, it deceives people, it deludes people. And by this measure, Ghana and Nigeria are the most divided, deceived, and deluded people in the world. Richard Dawkins, in his book, The God Delusion, has written extensively about...
God's not happy with what you're saying.
Oh, right. Okay, well, he's written about The God Delusion, and that book has dealt a blow to religion, probably a blow from which it will never recover. Now, and people still wince when they hear the word atheist. But what you'll find after joining a community of atheists is that it feels like probably the most natural thing in the world. We believe it's an intellectually the most honest position, because it just answers the one question: do you believe God exists? And what we say is that as there's no evidence for a God, we don't believe a God exists. If there was evidence, we'd have to, but so far we've been waiting 2,000 years, at least in the case of one of the religions, and we haven't seen any evidence whatsoever. And that is pretty much all there is to atheism. It's very simple. The rest of it is philosophy, it's humanism, it's science, it's this and that, but it's not atheism. And what we're hoping to do is just encourage people to come out more and more, and hopefully it will reach a tipping point where atheists are now actually the most numerous and people people will hopefully feel ashamed to identify themselves as religious. Now, just over a year ago, we had a remarkable man who, as soon as he knew about the existence of London Black Atheists, said he would come to London to speak to us. He flew over from Germany, where he's doing a PhD in Bayreuth University, and he gave a talk on breaking the taboo of atheism in black communities. The talk is on YouTube and has been viewed nearly 4,000 times, which is very respectable indeed. And he's an active human rights campaigner, particularly in the field of hunting the witch hunters. And he's been thrown into jail for his activism, but far from deterring him, it has made him more determined than ever. So, ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together and give a warm welcome to Mr. Leo Igwe.
Thank you, friends. Thank you for honoring our invitation. I'm going to show two videos. This is a witch trial session that took place maybe some months ago. So this very one was a man that was accused of witchcraft and taken to a shrine. The person is tried and tested. So they believe that the shrine priest is not the one that will really determine who is a witch. It is the gods we determine. But the gods will determine, not really by revelation, but they will determine that through the broom. Two brooms will be used, maybe across the neck, this way. And if they don't separate, then that means that the person is a witch. So that was actually what happened to the man at the shrine. Now, when you are accused, the woman has to sit on a mortar, just a small mortar, and the stuff here, this is the calabash, it contains what they call the spiritual water. Now, the shrine priest is going to dip the broom into the water, into this pot. And of course, that makes the broom sacred. And you will see how he's going to use it. Or there are two brooms, actually. How he's going to use them. Then if the brooms are separate, that means that this woman is not a witch. And this took place in sometime December, January. Okay, you can see that. So it means that this woman is not a witch. If he pulls that this way and puts it across the neck, the woman is not a witch. But this is going to be a different case when it comes to this woman. So the woman has to make a swear, take an oath. If I'm the one, the gods should expose me. If I'm not the one, the gods should free me. Yeah, you see it. So that's it. It's not the best of videos, but that is what is happening. And it is important we portray this in the way it is happening. So, if one hates a woman and wants to get rid of her, if one dislikes particularly an elderly female member of the family and wants to destroy her socially, one of the most effective ways of getting rid of her is by accusing her of witchcraft. And this is the case in northern Ghana, where I'm doing my fieldwork, as in other parts of the continent. Now, among the Dagombas, the Dagomba is an ethnic group in the north of Ghana. It's the largest ethnic group in northern Ghana. The name for a witch is Sonya. That's what you call a witch. And the name for a wizard, that's a male witch, if I should say something like that, is Bukpaha. But in the local discourse, there is often no reference to Bukpaha. They don't talk about it. You don't just get it often. Sonya is commonly used sometimes or many times to refer to persons, male or female, who engage in witchcraft. So, like, when I arrived in the north of Ghana, I went to some young people and I told them that I was doing some research on witchcraft accusation. So when they said, one of them said, Sonya. Another one said, Pakurugu, that is an elderly woman. Another name for a witch is an elderly woman. So That is it, the two, they go together among the people, among the Dagombas. So among the Dagombas, the notion of witchcraft has a female face. Though men are accused, men are involved, as they believe. But men, most times, are perceived as doctors. That are called, they are the ones that can, if there is a case of witchcraft, you go and invite them to come and find out who is the witch and exorcise the person. The female face of witchcraft is evident in the way the witch camps in the north of Ghana are described. Now, when you go to the camps in the north of Ghana, they call them old ladies section, or old ladies area. So if you are going to the witch camp, that's what they describe, the local name, they call it old ladies area. And the funny thing there is that when you go to one of the witch camps, you have men. But the name is old ladies area. So witchcraft accusation is a potent means of turning the society against an unwanted woman, a woman who has become a burden to the family or a liability to the community, a woman who has outlived her usefulness. You may not actually hate a woman before accusing her of witchcraft. Yes. So it's not just necessary that one is a woman, then the woman is a witch, or you need to hate that woman. You may be looking for a scapegoat for the problems you face or for the misfortunes you suffer. Witchcraft narratives are evoked to explain problems like death or what they call bad death. Yes. For them, the notion of bad death is like when somebody dies, is it middle age or something? Yeah, when you're in your 50s, 40s or something, if you die, maybe people call that bad death. Or when you die at the peak of your career, or a bank manager suddenly died in a motor accident, they call that bad death. So they report that believing witchcraft was hampering the treatment of Ebola in West Africa should not come as a surprise to anyone. Witchcraft is an epidemiological narrative. That is, witchcraft is invoked to make sense of a situation where people are plagued by strange, uncanny, or incurable illness. Yes, you know, people are trying to get a cure for Ebola. So this is a kind of terrain, you know, this is a kind of condition, it's under this context that people evoke witchcraft. Had it been there's a cure or something, you could go to the pharmacy and buy it or go to the hospital, then people don't usually invoke, you know, the narrative of witchcraft. So the epidemiological narrative of witchcraft is not strictly an African formation. Yes, you see, when they were portraying that, of course, they tried to say, yes, Ebola is, we're having the cases in Africa, in West Africa particularly. So, but it is something that also resonates. It's something that you can find in other cultures or cultural formations. It has both Christian and Islamic dimensions. And one of the marketers of the Christian formation of witchcraft is in London this week. Yes, at least by virtue of the advertisement. Yes, that's Bishop Oyedepo. He's coming to London this week. So generally, people can easily make scapegoats of anybody, rich or poor, young or old, male or female, literate or illiterate. Members of a community can entertain suspicion or insinuate occult harm or hideous schemes to injure or kill others. Very often, many accusations end up at the level of improper application due to the inability of the accusers to effectively sanction the accused. So that it is not just in every case of suspicion or accusation that you get people thrown out. You get people taken to the shrine for trial. You can accuse somebody, but you are afraid of confronting the person with the accusation. So what you do is that, you know, you just stay by the side and keep pointing, accusing fingers, oh, that wicked woman, that woman that doesn't want to die, others and keep killing others, that woman that keep eating the soul of children. Because you know, if you go and confront this woman directly, you know, the children might come after you, the children might, you know, come out to defend her and all that. So it is not always the case that Immediately you suspect somebody of witchcraft, the person is accused or the person is driven out. Many times, communities live in a situation of what I call, is it perpetual suspicion, constant suspicion, every day. Because there's always a tendency that, there's something this man is doing. You know, there's something he's burying in front of the door or put at the doorpost or in the farm, and that thing could kill spiritually. So accusations remain at the level of suspicion and insinuations, rumors, hearsay, finger pointing, frowning, covert or implied references, as in expressions, like among the Igbos in Nigeria, there's this expression, they say, Odieshi. Odieshi means that, yes, those magical things you are doing, they are not going to affect me. I have fortified myself. So as you are doing it, I am repelling it. It's not physical. But you see people quarreling, you say, don't worry. You, I will deal with you. Say, Odieshi. They're kind of nothing. Because the person feels, people feel, not only that they are physically fortified, physically they say that you are strong enough to fight somebody, that they are also spiritually fortified. So there are two levels of war, two levels of accusations or two levels of conflict going on. You have the physical one, you have the spiritual one. And witchcraft accusation locks within the spiritual. Now, you also hear some Christians, sometimes when you say something, they say, back to sender. Yes. When they say back to sender, it's not really that there is anything. It's just something you said. But they feel that thing can have some spiritual implication, spiritual damage. So they say that it should go back to the person who said it. And such statements could create a situation of accusation because you might go home and maybe you start having, you know, either backache or something. You say, maybe the thing came back, you know. So before you know it, it starts forming in your mind, particularly the pain persists, you are taken to a hospital, you could not get a cure, and all that and all that. So before you know it, that accusation, the suspicion, you know, start growing there. So there are other similar declarations that people make. People perceive victims of accusation use in processing, neutralizing, or countering any purportedly occult scheme against them. Improper application of witchcraft label leaves both the accuser and accused in a state of mutual suspicion and fear of attack. But in some cases, witchcraft insinuations are not enough. You know, you could, neighbors could be living, that man, yes, he's been into some occult things. He's been doing some magical harm. He's been trying to kill, he's been trying to frustrate me. You'll be living under suspicion. Now, maybe suddenly, your father collapsed and died. Your child collapsed and died. You say, yes. So most times we have a situation of insinuation waiting for a trigger. Yes. And that trigger could be in form of sudden death, accident, unexplained illness, uncanny, strange manifestations, and all that. So immediately that it serves as a trigger. Now, suspicion now will turn to accusation. That is one way. Immediately it happens, you say, enough. Enough. You will see them talking. They say, enough. I have had enough. You have had enough of what? The person can't make statements that has evidence. You have been doing it. You have been trying this. But now is enough. Now, that trigger now emboldens the person to go and say yes. And sometimes when you are coming, you will come with physical weapon to confront somebody who has attacked you spiritually. You can see the thing. So that's what happens in the case. In a case like this. So the label is properly and successfully applied. The witch is named and shamed, attacked, beaten, banished, murdered, or murdered in cold blood, like what we've seen here. What happened in the first case was that the first child died, the second child died. The woman had two sons, so two of them are dead. And two of them died maybe within a space of 1 year. So he accused the uncle of being responsible because he said that the uncle went into the room where one was lying, critically ill, and gave him something. What is that? The woman could not explain to me. Because the belief is that whatever it is, it could be food, it could be biscuits, it could be whatever, anything, sandwiches, anything, You can put it there and the person eats it and the person is dead. But I asked them, can you tell me exactly what that thing is? Nobody knows. They told me it is the witch that knows what it uses to kill. And somebody will come and tell you, this is a witch, he killed this person. With what? That's a challenge. I went to a family that I drove out an old woman, and the case went to the police. I saw the woman at the police station. Now I followed them. I went to the family, and I met the accuser, a man, an elderly man. So the man was furious. So he told me, look, upon what this family did to me, they still went and reported me to the police. I asked him, what did they do to you? They killed, the woman from that family killed the son. In other words, the man was complaining as if these people have victimized me or tried twice. And you know, he's very angry. You have killed my son, you have taken me to the police. Because taking people to the police is actually a very serious matter, because you are going to spend money. Forget about the law. It's the law, it's the extortion you are afraid of. Yes. So upon what this woman did to me, the sons now took me to the police. He was very angry. Now, I said that to him, I said, what did they do? He said, that the woman killed the son. I said, how did you know the woman killed the son? That the son, before he died, saw the woman in his dream. Because they believe in, the one I'm explaining is that among the Dagombas in the north, but these are, it can apply to other cultures. Now, the belief there is that when you see somebody in a dream, it's the person that appeared in the dream. Okay? Not that maybe these are the image of the person, you know, suppressed, the person you saw during the day, and it comes up in the night when you're sleeping and all that. So the belief is that a witch appears in a dream. So if somebody is sick and you are seeing one old woman in the dream, that old woman is the one responsible. So the old woman, if you tell your father or your family members, they will go and accuse the person. So I asked them, could they tell me what the woman used to kill the young man? They were like, they looked at me. They asked me, are you Dagomba? I said, no. They said, you will not understand. I said, no. Explain this thing to me. What is it I will not understand? Explain to me. You say this person killed this woman and all that. What did the person use? They said, I will not understand. So that it is not just only sometimes people who come from maybe outside Africa who encounter some of this barrier, this cultural stuff. Sometimes even when you come from there, they will still tell you if you are not maybe... If they know you're African, they say, oh, you are not African of this that belongs to this cultural group, so you will not understand. So I told them that, look, I wanted to help them, because at the police station, the police will ask them to produce what they said the woman used to kill the young man. Well, at the end of the day, they drove me out, actually, because they got very upset, because they felt I wasn't sympathetic, you know. They told me to go, that they were still very angry that I should go. I left. Yeah. So this is how the accusation arises and all are processed by some members of the community. So in patriarchal societies like what we have, men are the heads of the families. Women are often the ones who are accused, because women are the lower ranks of the social ladder. Because like now among the Dagombas, polygamy, I think that's what they call it, you know, having many wives, is almost the culture. Yes. So, and sometimes in polygamous families, the elderly women are accused. In a particular community, they invited the witch finders. And the witch finders, when they came, they said that those who have women who have passed the age of, is it 40 or 50, should stay one end. And those who are under 40 or something should stay on another end. Then from those who are above 40, that's where they selected the witches, those who are the responsible for the witchcraft today. In the community. And one of the victims told me that actually it was people in the family that sent her name to the witch finders, you know, and she was identified and sacked. Now, when these people are sacked, they go to what we call the witch camps. This is a witch camp, and the closest river is around 3 kilometers. So I went to the witch camp, and I wanted to know the distance. So as I was coming from the stream, and I saw this old woman. She was accused and driven out of her community, and she went to the river with a walking stick, and is coming back here, and I saw her. And I was asking myself, well, how long will this woman do this before she dies? She's living alone, cooking her own food, doing everything on her own. Now, this is another woman again that was accused. But this woman was lucky. She had relatives, she had members of the family who rallied behind her, who came around to support her. So she didn't go to the camp. She went to stay with one of the family members living in Tamale. And that was where, you know, I caught up with her. So we met and she told me what happened. It was still a case of death in the family. And she was blamed. She was told to be responsible. She was accused of being responsible for the death. In fact, one member of the family said that she saw this woman in the dream throwing stones at her. So she was accused and she was driven out. So the chief was in support of the accusation. And the family brought a human rights abuse case against the chief and the family members. So that's how the chief was able to, you know, revise the decision, and the woman went back to the community. Now, Abibat, that's the name of the woman lying there, she couldn't make it. She couldn't make it to the camp. She was accused of witchcraft by the stepson. So I think one evening she went out to the field and the stepson confronted her and stabbed her to death. Because the stepson said he went to, they call them shrine priest or a soothsayer. And the soothsayer, they will do some consultation. They will look at cowries and tell you who is the witch in the family. And he came back and stabbed the woman to death. This happened in 2010. The case is still in court. The guy who stabbed the woman to death is on remand, but they couldn't allow me to see him. But they gave me access to the case file. That was where I got this. You know, I got this photo. Now, this is another interesting case. So this woman, I saw her this year at one of the camps. A family member was electrocuted in Accra, the capital of Ghana. So they brought the funeral. They came to the village to do the funeral. And what they do is that before the funeral, they go to consult the soothsayers who will tell them, yes, look at what killed this person, or look at who was responsible, or who is responsible for a particular case of death. So they went and said that the woman was responsible. That the woman was responsible for the death of the person who was electrocuted. But this woman made a very thoughtful and insightful statement. He told me, look, I have not seen electricity all my life. How could I turn to an electric current when I didn't know what electricity was? Friends, I must let you know, that was when I, in quote now, I fell in love with the woman. Because I said, if this woman could think this way, I mean, because some people think that critical thinking is only for the educated, right? Only people who are, this woman is not educated, she didn't go to school and all that, but she was able to think this way. In fact, that was what made me, I said, okay, I was going to support her. Because there were so many of them in the camp. So there was some funding we got from Foundation Beyond Belief in the US. So she was able to benefit from that funding. And she left the witch camp, and she's now trying to start a business on her own. So people believe that you can turn to electricity. So if you get electrocuted, somebody turned to electricity to kill the person. Now, if you are going across the river and maybe something happens to the bridge, they say, they have given him to the river. They have given her to the river. They will not say, but the bridge was bad and all that and all that. No. If you have an accident, they say they have given him to the road. Yeah. It is not that maybe there was, you know, the person was careless in driving. So most times when there are cases of death, people leave the actual case, people leave the facts. They will go to the village and start, you know, processing fiction. So another woman, Melatu, was accused by the daughter of being responsible for her illness. Because it's not only in polygamous families, you can also have it in nuclear families. In this case, the daughter of a woman accused her of being responsible for the illness, because the lady was ill for a very long time. So the woman was taken to a shrine. It was the same, that trial, like the one I showed you, that was where the woman was, that was the very trial. You know, it was there the woman was tried, and she was convicted and driven out of the village. So vulnerable members of the population are not necessarily female. They can be male, young or old, poor or rich. It is not all elderly women or men, not all boys and girls that are branded witches. Yes. And you know, we have to you know, understand this, because when we say it's poor people, not all poor people. It's women, not all women. I went throughout the witch camp. I never saw a woman that finished primary school, that had primary education, all the witch camps, none. In fact, one of my greatest challenges is translation, because I don't speak the local language. Yes. But not all of them, not all illiterate women in the north of Ghana are in the witch camps. There are illiterate women with educated children who will be ready to protect them when they're accused. Like the one I told you that took the accuser to the police. So witches, in quote, are those from weak social political base, those unable to successfully contest accusations made against them. The tragedy is that believing witchcraft has often been used to process social problems. But why is this the case in the north of Ghana, and why is this the case in many parts of Africa? The education system in black communities has failed to provide the cognitive dissonance needed for the eradication of witchcraft-related abuse. Just, I had an interview shortly before we started, and there was this question of education, whether education in black communities is addressing the problem. I said, it's not education. What kind of education are people getting? That's the problem. What kind of education are people getting? Many people get educated because they think that is a way to, is it, climb the social ladder, get a good job, you know, get reasonable income and all that. That's all. So what is happening is that the education that many people receive, let's say in Africa and in the black communities, there is something missing. There's something missing in it, and we have to point out that thing. Critical thinking is missing. Reason, rational thinking is missing. Scientific thinking is missing. The quest for truth is missing. Evidence, seeking evidence, is missing. Instead, what is filled with dogma, of course, brainwashing. And I told some friends somewhere that who owns the schools we're talking about? Who owns the schools? Pastors, imams, sheikhs. These are people who own the schools. So what kind of education do you expect from Christian schools, from faith schools? Trojan horse education, right? Yeah. That's what you expect from there. Education that comes as if it's enlightenment, but it's indoctrinment. Because it locks the minds of these people. But giving them a surface of enlightenment, that's what happens. In Nigeria, we have universities all over the place, private, state, polytechnics, all over the place. But before you start the day, you start with prayers. And you call on God to help you understand what you're learning and things like that. And when they try to when you want to question witchcraft, they say, look, you are using the Western mentality. Yes, it is the Western people that question witchcraft, right? Africans, they're not. They have been mentally engineered not to question. And when it comes to witchcraft. And I was in a class where, a philosophy seminar class, where a lecturer, yes, in quote, was trying to teach us witchcraft and magic as African science. Yes. That's what they call it, African science. Oh, you know African science. I said, what is African science? But don't make any mistake. When you come here, you come and you tell us that, you know, observation, experimentation are Western scientific model. You are encouraging that notion indirectly. I know Babu raised this issue when we were at the IHU World Congress. I think, am I correct? Something like that, yeah. So, because somebody was talking about a Western scientific model, what does that mean? Can you tell me what it means? Science is science. If you conduct the experiment in my village and conduct it here, you will get the same result. Now, if you conduct that experiment in my village, it's what? African science in, Western science in African village, okay? Then if you do the witchcraft thing, it is African science in Western city, right? I mean, we're confusing ourselves and confusing people, for goodness sake. So this is what plays into the hands of many of these intellectuals who peddle the notion of African science. There's nothing like African science. Superstition is not African science, for goodness sake. So, but that is it. Yes. So this is the challenge we get in terms of education. So at the master's level, the man was teaching us. Now, let me tell you the example he gave that I was so angry. He made me so angry in the class. He said that there is an African way of, orthopedic. Don't mind me, my English is not very good. So sometimes I have some Nigerian English. I speak some Nigerian English. Yeah, so, you know, orthopedic, you know, the bone problems. If you have that bone problem, that there's an African way of doing it. So you know what the African way he taught us in the philosophy of science class was that if you have a fracture, so you go to a witch doctor, a traditional medicine man, so they will get chicken and break the bone of the chicken. Now, when the bone of the chicken, of that chicken, when the own, is it fracture, so that of the chicken, when it heals, your own will heal. What is the science in this thing? I'm asking you people, what's the science in this? What is the science in it? What is the connection between the fracture of the chicken and the fracture of a human being? What's the connection? Is there anything that will go from that fracture to your own? You said, okay, when this thing is in contact, it will heal it. No. And even if, for instance, you take the blood or whatever and rub it on your own, I will also ask you, what is the effect? What does that mean? But you see people teach this in the school, and you are telling me the person is educated? No. Unless maybe the meaning of education is different. And the one they taught me, I learned, is educo. Yes. To lead people out. Lead people out of ignorance. In this educational institution, you know what they're doing? They are leading people into ignorance. So they are going the reverse. And that is why they have not generated the social critical mass to tackle these problems. Make no mistake about this. I am sure that witchcraft did not end automatically. In other words, everybody, you know, I'm talking of the witch hunting, it may not have ended completely. Let's leave that for academic sessions, okay? So, but here, witchcraft accusation did not just end that way. Slowly. It went round, you know, the whole thing, the message started spreading. But now the people who are supposed to spread the message so that it percolates down the rank are the ones reinforcing the message. So that's it, it's locked up. This poor woman never went to school. And look, as poor as she is, she knew that, look, there's no way she could turn to electric current because she had not seen electric current before. She didn't know what it was. So our educational system. Now, death can be spiritually caused by some people. Yes, when people die in communities, what they do is that people have to look for who killed this person. There's one thing they say in my language. They say that, yeah, it's a rough translation. They say, this death is not empty-handed. You know, there must be a hand behind this death. It's the hand of who? A witch. That's what they're looking for. Immediately they tell you, there's a hand behind this death. That is it. So they start looking for that hand. People are accused. People are driven out. People are beaten. People are lynched. So there is also this trend, very disturbing trend, in contemporary social criticism here in Europe. The reluctance by scholars and intellectuals to criticize cultures and religions, African cultural issues, for instance. They refuse to apply the standards used in sociocultural analysis here in Europe. Yes, that's the trend I noticed as I'm doing my research. I was in a class and they told me witchcraft is superstition. That then in Africa, I said, witchcraft is superstition. They said, no. I said, why? Witchcraft is superstition. If witchcraft is superstition in Europe, why is it not superstition in Africa? They said, it is condescending. They start using some words. It's derogatory, it's judgmental, it's normative. They keep invoking. And as they are invoking all these, is it adjectives? They are not making any sense. I said, all these adjectives they are giving me, has it turned witchcraft into science in Africa? No. Yeah. And again, these people can go ahead and practice witchcraft. Okay? Yes, because for them it's science. For them it makes sense. But it doesn't make sense to us. No. There's some kind of racism there. If that's the way I look at it. Oh, yeah, it's good for them, but it's not good for us. Why is it good for them? They say, oh, no, you don't want to impose your cultural norms on them. Really? Mm-hmm. Only when it comes to witchcraft? That's why you don't want to impose cultural norms? I mean, they keep giving all sorts of excuses. In fact, there was this case of modernity of witchcraft. I read it when I was doing my work, that's in Africa, before I went to Germany. They said that witchcraft is part of African modernity. Why is it not part of European modernity? Nobody explains. Why is it part of African modernity? So, and many people are using it there to make people to understand that witchcraft has some legitimacy, it has some validity, there's some veracity, and it functions for, there's this functional thing, it functions for Africans. Why is it not functioning for you people here in the West? Why? If it is not functioning for you people here in Europe, then if you think it's functioning, then there is something wrong with it. Now there was, I will soon round up, please. There was a journalist that sent me some questionnaires recently. It's connected with what I've just said now. He told me that Africans will be coming to the World Cup. And usually they used to come with some juju and charms and all that, you know, as part of the fans. Yes, as part of them. And he told me that, don't I think that actually Africans will look stupid if they come with all these witchcraft things to the World Cup? That's the one they just finished. Well, I paused a bit. I thought about it. I said, well, I agree. Yes, they will look stupid, right? But when Kaka, the one from Brazil, he scored and, you know, pulled up the jersey and said, I belong to Jesus. Nobody thought that looked stupid. Is Jesus a player? Does Jesus score goal? What is the connection between belonging to Jesus and scoring a match? Nothing. And I told the lady in the interview, because it was a written interview she sent to me via email, I said, look, anybody who thinks that witchcraft, you know, they carry some skulls and some frightening things with all the colors in the world, yellow, green, you know, and move around the pitch and all that, anybody who looks at this and says it's stupid and does not regard this as stupid, that there's something wrong in the person's sense of judgment. That interview was not published. Yeah. No, I mean, you will see Saudi Arabia, if they are playing World Cup, it's penalty time. They will turn that place into a mosque. They will turn it into a mosque. Immediately they score, they will do like this. They will do that thing. I don't know where they face. Is it this way or that way? I don't know. Do you get it? They will do it. Even though at the end of the day, they will lose. I mean, Saudi Arabia has never, with all the Allah and all the pilgrimages they're doing there, they hardly get over the group stages, you know. Do you get it? Now, that one is not stupid, right? It's not stupid. It's witchcraft. Is that is stupid. What is it? Something is missing. Yes. So that is the challenge we're having. Scholarship. So what do we do? We need to engage in self-criticism and examination of these beliefs that are used to abuse our children, torture and kill the elderly, victimize vulnerable members of the community. Yes, we need to start that, the process of criticism in our communities. So London Black Atheists, yes, Clive said, yeah, London Black Atheists is meant to encourage Black Atheists to come out, right? Yeah. To come out and do what? That's it. When you come out, what do? You loiter? You go around and you carry the badge of an atheist? No. You come out and start the work, because there's a work to be done. And you can't do that in hiding. You can't do that inside the shells. You can't do that at the back of the door. Yes, you have to come out in the open for the work to start. And you know you have an assignment this week, the protest against Bishop Oyedepo, right? Yes, that is why we are forming London Black Atheists. Yes. That's it. That's why we're forming it. We can't form it and that's it. If you come out, you are not ready to do anything, please go back. Yeah. You come out and engage the society. You come out and contribute to the society. You come out and bring critical thinking, you know, to the disposal of people. You come out and use the critical platform and weapon to help the people, to save lives. Yes. Atheism saves life. Saves lives that would have been destroyed by theists. We have seen that now. So when you, as London Black Atheists are coming out, they should be ready to work. They should be ready to fight using ideas, values of critical thinking and scientific temper. We should not shy away from calling witch burning in our communities gruesome, horrendous, barbaric practices. Yes. You know, I worked for an organization when I said, witch hunting is a barbaric practice by Africans. He said, no, Leo, don't use that kind of word. I said, okay. When you use it here to describe what's going on in your communities, it's just fine. But who wants to use it if it's something more horrible? They said, don't use it. Let's call this thing by its name so that it can go. Because when you use euphemisms, you know that this thing is horrible. This thing is blood, you know, is it bloodletting or things like that? Let's call it graphically by its name. Now, that woman that died now, how do we describe it? You start saying, it's some accident, right? I don't know. You guys know a lot of English. You know, you can get some more words. I don't have any, it's cruel, it's inhuman, destructive. Let's use all words charged enough so that when people want to do things like that, they think twice. We should object to the idea of being tagged Western when we question religion, dogma, or superstition. Yes. When we raise that issue, people call us Western. We should make people understand that rational thinking is not Western. And I want to say it here, it's not. People in my communities were questioning even before I had the word Western. They were suspecting people. When people make claims that they could do this and that, they will doubt those things. So, but as I was growing up, I made to understand that when you are questioning, you are critical, you are skeptical, you are Western. That's rubbish. That's what I'm concerned. It's complete nonsense. You are just human. All these are sentiments, all these are powers, all these are skills that are in us. And we need to use that to help our society without creating all these categories that are hampering the course of, you know, reformation. Cases of witchcraft-related abuse in Black communities in the UK outrage many people across the world. They point to beliefs and practices with deep roots in religious and cultural beliefs of the people in Black community. Many people regard these beliefs as part of their culture, and because of that, it's hampering efforts to tackle and eradicate them. So these beliefs have gone unchallenged because skeptics and freethinkers and atheists in Black communities have refused to speak out. So now is the time to break the silence. Yes, we broke the taboo of atheism, right? Yep. That's what we did. We did it last year. Yep. We are not breaking it again. We have broken it already. Okay? Now is to break the taboo of silence. Silence on or over, I don't know, theism-related abuses. religion-related abuses. We have to break the silence. Because already we have broken the silence, we now can't say we are atheists. So we have to break the next level of silence by speaking out. We have to campaign to stop witch hunters. We need to name and shame them, whether they are pastors or imams or traditionalists, because occult entrepreneurs are recharging the witchcraft narratives, marketing them to gullible and credulous folks. And some of them are waxing strong. And do you know what's happening? Do you people know what is happening? Do you want me to tell you what's happening now? Good. There's a campaign going on. The Christianity your forefathers brought to Africa, we are bringing it back to you. Well, I don't think it's something you should clap for, but that's fine. Back to sender. Yes, Africans are doing back to sender. So they are coming back. They're bringing them back now. But they're bringing them back not in the same form you brought them. They're bringing them back in a more violent, virulent form. I know people might start going to that comparison. More violent, more virulent is always violent. Let's leave that. Yes. They're bringing them back. And they're bringing them back in different forms and packages. We are saying, oh, it was Winner's Chapel. That is his own forum. That is his own package. They're doing European Winners Convention. Yes, that's the name. That's the name of this European Winners Convention. Now, Helen Upabio was here in April this year. Now, this was a question she was asking in Nigeria. She's now asking it here. So let me tell you, look at it. Europeans, are you under witchcraft attack? Because this thing wasn't kept in Africa. They put this poster right here. So you should put Europeans here. Are you under witchcraft attack? Europeans, are you under ancestral spirit attack? Are you under mermaid spirit attack? They're asking you. Are we going to turn a blind eye on this? Is that what we're going to do? Now, Pastor Adeboye went to Australia and New Zealand to establish, grow the Redeemed Christian Church of God. During the campaign, you know, during the time there was this anti-gay legislation before our parliament, Adeboye made a statement. He said, look, that men marry men, that if men marry men, that human beings will go into extinction. You know, that was a statement he made and others. I'm sure Yemisi will explain that more, yeah, for us. So, and that was a time, you know, they were pushing that bill. Now, he is now going to Australia with a private jet and all that to go and do back to sender, okay? To go and establish the churches. What I'm saying is this, if we know how we fought the church in early modern Europe, we have to be ready to fight again. Yes, we have to be ready to fight again. Otherwise, what happened in the case of Kristy Bamu will happen. Victoria Climbie, it will happen. But remember, those systems are reactive. I was explaining to somebody, I said, now, think about how much resources, you know, we are expended to trace Boy Adams, you know, the case of Boy Adams. I mean, mobilizing people here and there. It is just one thing, superstition at work, somewhere, someday. And it's here, not at work there, it's at work here. So we have to make efforts and stop this witch hunter. Let them stop coming here. Yes, they should stay with us, you know, in Africa for now. Eh? So let's see how we can keep processing and reprocessing them, see whether we can make something out of them. But that they are bringing it here and you are keeping quiet, that you are keeping quiet, you are doing us a lot of harm. Let me tell you why. You are hurting our campaign against witch hunters in Africa because you are giving them legitimacy. You are providing them a base. You are giving them credibility, which they should not enjoy. And I want everybody who lives here today, in your own little way, help us in a way you can, to make sure that witch hunters are not given credibility by giving this free pass to Europe to come and spread their disease gospel. One of them, Oyedepo, is coming this week. He's doing a program here this week. Do you know what made Oyedepo very notorious? There are so many things, actually, that makes him notorious. He has a private jet, you know. Yes, a pastor has private, he has no job. His job is there. And he's riding private jets. Some of us, we are working for NGOs. We found it difficult to buy a motorbike. You get it? Somebody is a pastor, he's riding private jets, you know. And he doesn't hide it, you know. I don't know how to say it in English. He flouts his wealth, you know. Makes everybody to say it. Because it's a sign of blessing from God. But that's okay, exploitation. Fine, that's what he's doing. Yeah, he's doing his business. Some people are giving him the money. He was doing deliverance. And he said in the course of the deliverance, I think he said, "Where are you from?" The child said, "I'm not a witch, I'm a witch for Jesus." The guy was. Yeah, because I'm sure the girl was not properly coached, okay? You know, deliverance sessions, you know. Before the actual deliverance, there's a kind of briefing. the briefing, there was a problem in briefing those people who were exercised or something. So he said, I'm not a witch, I'm a witch for Jesus. I mean, he felt a kind of either insulted or whatever. And he slapped the girl. Now, I want to ask you a question. Just correct me and put me through. If such a thing happens here, what would be the case? What would be the case? No, I'm talking about if it happens here in the UK, a pastor slaps a girl, maybe in the church or something, in the course of this, what happens to the case? Police. Huh? Police. It becomes a police case. Police will come in, and I'm sure he will not get away, free, right? Now, he did it there. He's coming here. Do you want him to do it here? Can't we send a message to him that his brand of Christianity is not welcome here in the UK? And that if you did it here, that there are people that felt it. It's on YouTube. Put Oyedepo and all that. I had the link, but it couldn't play. So you get it on YouTube. Now, in addition, a few minutes, I'll be done. The branch of her church in Bamenda, Cameroon, the pastor at that church accused a girl of 9 years of being possessed by, how did they put it now? The girl was possessed by numerous spirits or something. Yeah. And in the course of exorcism, the girl collapsed and died. Yeah. Yes, that was what happened. And this is only the ones we have seen, maybe the ones that people reported and things like that. Many of such cases, they go underground. A church with that track record should not be given a free pass here. I don't know whether that is the best way to express it. Such a church like that should not be, you know, you should not legitimize what they're doing here. We should find a way to send them a message that their brand of Christianity is not welcome. That you know, if they really want to send back the Christianity, they should send the one you brought to Africa. Okay, that the one they were sending back is not actually the one they sent. Again, there are victims, and I'll wrap up with this. There are people who are victimized. We should support victims of abuses in the name of witchcraft, in the name of religion. We should not think that, yes, it suits them, right? After all, they went to church. After all, they believe in God. After all, they believe in demons. After all, they believe in witchcraft. No. We should reach out to them. Because I think that the humanist, skeptics, free thinkers, by virtue of their skepticism or rationality, they have a sense of compassion that is not, you know, you can't find, let's say, among the religious, because a religious person could say, look, this guy is just the person, right? But he said, no, this is an innocent person. So we need to develop programs to support victims of witchcraft accusation, witch hunting. I'll give you this example. I was in Gambaga, where you have one of the most notorious witch camps. And my research assistant in Gambaga is a pastor. So I arrived and he told me there was a case of accusation. So I told him, what did you do? Did you try to intervene in any way? He said, no, Lou, I couldn't intervene. I said, what happened? He said, you know, sometimes the devil might be at work. They believe in devil, they believe in evil spirits, stop people from reaching out. Does it stop you? Does it? If it doesn't stop you, then what are you doing? If it doesn't stop London Black Atheists, what are they doing? Now they have come out. That is it. It doesn't stop us. So that is why, where they think the devil is at work, we should move in and put humanism at work. Because that's where he's needed. So, atheists, agnostics, freethinkers should not shy away from this responsibility. If you ask me, I will tell you that's our own niche. Yeah, there are a lot of people who need help in across the world. But there are people who are doubly victimized because the people who could help them have this belief in the supernatural. We can come in there and make a difference in their lives. So if those who subscribe to an outlook that is free of superstition do not step forward and deliver the good of rational compassion, compassion that can flow from reason, to victims of witch hunting, who will? So friends, witch hunting must stop, whether here in Europe or in Africa. We have to stop it. Witch hunters, whether in Europe or in Africa, must be stopped. Thank you.